What's up, guys? I'm Alex.
I'm Jason. We're the Table Monkeys, and today's video is going to be about steroids.
The juice.
Them PEDs.
Yeah.
The extra gas.
That taboo subject that no one wants to talk about.
Yeah, no one wants to talk about it. Everybody. But we're going to talk about it. And we're also going to talk about the King's move. Yeah,
because apparently they're related.
Yeah, somehow they're connected. We don't understand it. Maybe you understand
it. We made a couple videos about the King's move, and apparently some people think the King's move is cheating, just like roids.
Just like steroids, yeah. And we have a couple comments. They'll come up on the screen. You can see exactly what they said. Basically, two separate people making the exact same point, that they think that the King's move is cheating because it's some sort of a bone lock, so therefore it's an advantage, and it's therefore it's cheating, and steroids is an advantage, so therefore it's cheating, and they fall into the same category.
That's wrong.
I would just say that's kind of ridiculous. So we're going to kind of, it just prompted us to talk about PEDs because both of us come from the fitness industry, and PEDs is kind of like a sort of underground taboo thing with the fitness industry. It's 100% part of the industry, but nobody really talks about it.
Yep.
Recently with YouTube, maybe in the last like five years, right? Maybe 10 years. So people have been a little bit more open about it. So there is some more knowledge in that industry about the
People started calling each other out for fake being natties. Fake natties. Yeah.
Yeah. It's a big thing, right? People, cause it creates a false, understanding or false
idea of what's possible naturally.
Right? Yeah, exactly.
So it's setting people up for failure.
Right.
And
either they're thinking, you know, I should be able to get there, and then they can't get anywhere close to it, so they think they suck, or they think, you know what, there's no way you can ever do that unless you just use tons of drugs, so then they don't ever try. And it's a big problem, so people, you know, bring a lot of attention to it to try to clarify the whole subject. And now we feel like arm wrestling is sort of like
once removed from the fitness industry, and then the fitness industry is like once removed from this whole world of steroids and
PEDs and everything. Yeah. So we were trying to kind of bridge the gap between the fitness industry and the arm wrestling community as far as like the training methodology and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But we figured, you know what? Let's talk about these roids, because a lot of misconceptions going on out there, right?
A lot of misconceptions.
Yeah. So I think let's start with like how did we originally feel about it? Like what I remember, we both have felt the same way, especially like you're 12 years younger than me. So when I was your age, I felt exactly the same way you did a little while ago about them, right? So let's start there.
Yeah, I mean, I guess it's hard to tell who's on steroids, but when you were growing up, you kind of just assumed that everyone at the top of their game was on steroids, especially in the fitness world. So like Phil Heath and Ryan Coleman, Kai Green.
I'd have to argue, I'd say that's even, again, as I just mentioned, the 12-year difference. When I grew up, it was still like it was still such a huge unknown.
Yeah.
That you like I grew up, I wasn't sure if Arnold was natural or not. Like I was convinced, like, no, there's a chance that he could be natural.
Yeah.
You know, like obviously I would look at like Ronnie Coleman and be like, okay, that's steroids.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's one of the big misconceptions, right, that it starts with, is that it's like a switch. So point being, I think both of us in the very beginning or earlier in our fitness career, we're 100% against it, right?
Mm-hmm.
We're like, no, it's 100% cheating, it's no good. And we all also viewed it as if it's kind of this on-off switch. Either you can, you can do this, or you can be a complete freak, and that's steroids.
Yeah, I mean, you can look natural and be on steroids.
Yeah.
And you don't work hard.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. There's a lot of people. There's probably five times more people, or maybe, I don't know, maybe Greg would say there's like 20 times more people that are on steroids and look like shit than people that are on steroids and actually look like they're on steroids.
Yeah, so there's a big spectrum of people taking steroids.
Yeah.
It's not like you take steroids and you instantly become Denis Cyplenkov.
Or LeVon.
Yeah.
Yeah. It is a spectrum, and there's also a huge variance of reason. Like at the very bottom of the spectrum,
right,
you have HRT or TRT, as it's referred to, which is hormone replacement therapy, and the main hormone is usually testosterone, so it's also referred to as TRT.
Now, people are taking really small doses just to get themselves back into normal levels,
exactly
what they should be for their age.
Yeah. And then that spectrum goes all the way up to, you know, in the middle, you've got your fake natties, guys that are on a little bit more than what might be natural, or they're on more, like they're older than they should be and they still look too good. Michael Hearn. So we're not saying like he's been crazy on steroids his whole life, but obviously as he's 50 years old and he looks better than he did at 30, there's no way he's achieved that over the last 10 years without some sort of assistance. It's just absolutely impossible. I'm not a, like calling him out because he still claims to be natural or anything, but it's, again, it's that misconception where it gives a false sense of possibilities to the industry to think that you could look like Michael Hearn in, at any time natural, is just unfortunately not realistic, right? Yeah. So so we want to kind of clarify that spectrum a little bit, right?
Yeah. So in the video you made about your journey going through cancer, you mentioned how you were on HRT. So why did you start taking HRT, and what were you experiencing before you started taking it?
Yeah, exactly. So that's one of the things we want to talk about, is like there's a lot of medical reasons why you'd want to use testosterone or even a lot of these other steroids or PEDs. A lot of them start for medical reasons, like for people that have atrophy or burn victims or AIDS patients, cancer patients, all that kind of stuff, that they're going to help them grow back to a normal state without, you know, just deteriorating to nothing. So for me, after, if you haven't seen the video, there's a video that I did about my cancer story. I had testicular cancer and I had to go through chemo and a whole bunch of other shit. But the main things that led to the hormone deficiency was being one testicle down. So your testicles are what produce your testosterone. So once I have only one testicle, I'm only going to produce half as much as I would have ever produced naturally. And then on top of that, chemotherapy can really deplete your system or kind of damage it. And so I went through chemo. A year and a half later, my testosterone was still rock bottom. Now, what does low testosterone feel like? It feels like shit. It feels, you're completely depressed. You have no motivation. You have no sex drive. You have no drive really to do anything. And you're grumpy. The mood swings for me were horrible. Like the idea of a grumpy old man. Well, the reason that's happening is because once you're in your 80s, you're producing like absolutely no testosterone anymore. And it affects you negatively.
Yeah.
And then on top of that, living for a long time with low testosterone, aside from all the psychological and mental problems that go along with it, it also is unhealthy as far as cholesterol, sleep, fat gain, heart disease. Like there's a lot of reasons why it's bad for you.
So there's a lot of problems associated with being really low in testosterone, and then you get to the other end of the spectrum where you start taking large amounts of steroids.
There's
not just testosterone.
Yeah, it's all the same kind of problems again.
Blood pressure, kidney problems, liver failure, heart problems.
Exactly.
So that's a big difference between what an HRT cycle looks like versus what a real steroid cycle would look like with these, like what these athletes are taking.
Yeah. So again, it's a big spectrum here. And it basically, the bottom side of the spectrum is your HRT patient who is using testosterone to replace what they should have but don't have for some reason. Now that could be a medical issue like chemotherapy and testicular cancer, or that could be you're just old. Somebody who's 65 years old and wants to feel like they're 35 again, well, guess what? Testosterone is going to do that for you for the most part.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what a lot of the HRT doctors are prescribing it for. It's for people who are in their 40s, 50s, and 60s and want to still feel young and stay active and be able to do what they wanted to do. So we're going to call that assisted, right?
Low doses.
Low doses. Yeah. But if you're assisted, you're still
not natural.
Not at all.
No.
No more natural. And just think about this spectrum as well with drugs, right? Like we were talking earlier about caffeine. So like caffeine is legal. It's fine. It's not a problem. But it's still a performance enhancer. You go do a bike race this week and then no caffeine at all, and go the week later and do the exact same bike race on 500 milligrams of caffeine. Guess what? Your time's going to improve. Like no question, right?
So
with that spectrum now, once you're on any kind of HRT, you're assisted in any way, shape, or form, you're not natural at all. Now, the assisted or HRT doses are going to run somewhere in the 200 milligrams of testosterone a week. But for the most part, for us here in Canada, and it all varies based on the country and the laws and stuff, mm-hmm. but for us in Canada, your average HRT dose is going to be about 150 milligrams a week. You're going to have a hard time getting more than that prescribed. for someone, let's say someone who is a powerlifter and they're state champion, top five nationally kind of a thing, right? That kind of person is going to be on probably upwards of like 600 to 800 milligrams of testosterone, plus they're going to be taking two or three other types of androgynous hormones. So those come in oral forms, those are other injectables. And once you're on that much gear, as it's called, you also have to start taking things to counter the side effects of all that shit. And if you're not really on top of it with blood work and making sure that everything is where it's supposed to be, it can be really easy to get out of whack once you're in that kind of dosage, you know, to get messed up. And when we're talking like Mr. Olympia, World's Strongest Man levels, we're talking like 2,000 milligrams, like literally 2 grams of testosterone a week, 4 or 5 different androgynous testosterones, 2 or 3 different counter drugs. Like the drug regimen becomes ridiculous at the super, super, super high end. Like LaVon and Dennis, they pay as much attention to their chemistry as they do to their reps and weights and diet. 100%.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't really think arm wrestlers pay much attention at all to their diet, so maybe diet is out of there.
Yeah, so maybe LaVon doesn't really care too much about his diet. Going to McDonald's before a workout, eating 5,000 calories. And obviously now we know our boy, Devin Larratt, kind of found out that corn-fed pumps might not be the best kind of pumps.
Might not be the healthiest pumps,
yeah. Yeah. But on a side note, I mean, we're both chefs, so if either of you two guys are looking for some diet tips...
Yeah, we've been thinking about that, maybe doing some, you know, high-protein, you know, low-calorie, dense food cooking videos, so...
Hey, if you guys are interested, let us know.
I know we're not in... At least I'm not in the best shape, but we know how to cook.
Yeah. All right, guys, we got a little off-topic. Back to the subject at hand. Steroids, it's a large spectrum from the lowest doses of HRT to the most enhanced.
To Plankoff's World's Strongest Man,
we're
Phil
taking
Heath,
giant stacks Ryan of steroids Coleman's. Every week.
Yeah.
There's a steroid to help every aspect of performance that you want.
Whether it's being faster, better endurance, stronger, more explosive, more
so
aggressive.
So will they help you in arm wrestling?
Obviously. Pretty much everything that I just said is a factor in arm wrestling. So clearly they can help you. But will they make you a better arm wrestler?
No.
Will they make you a world champion?
No.
Is the world champion of arm wrestling on steroids?
Possibly.
That's a reference to our other video. Go check it out. But yeah, the point, again, is that they are a factor in some sports, but they do not do the work for you. What you need to win a sport is a competitive advantage. And you have to earn competitive advantages. And competitive advantages and cheating kind of seem to ride a line, and people seem to see this as a gray area. And then that's where this confusion comes, where people think that having a bone lock in arm wrestling is cheating, and therefore it's just the same as using steroids, which is also cheating, and every line in their head seems to be confused, like none of this makes any sense.
Yeah.
So some examples of like a competitive advantage, right? Like in a sport, there are rules. If you can push, everybody who's going for competitive advantage is going to push those,
right.
those
if,
rules.
If
right?
I'm playing soccer and I score a goal and in the replays, people notice that I was actually offside, but the ref called it as
a
goal.
Or
didn't call the offside.
Yeah.
Then tough luck.
I mean, it's not cheating. He didn't cheat. He was playing the game and the ref missed the call. And same thing, if the ref made the call, he's still not cheating. That's just the game. It's no different, again, like in basketball, if I know you're going to make the basket, so I give you a hard foul so that you have to shoot the free throws, I get the foul. That's not cheating. That's part of the game. You know, that's just using the game and playing to the edge of the game. So like in arm wrestling, it'd be like if you had a shitty grip, And you go for a false start. You intentionally false started. You knew you were going to get a warning or a foul, depending on the league and the rules.
Mm-hmm.
But you didn't want that shitty grip, so you were looking for a competitive advantage, right?
Yeah. Or you're mid-match and you know you're about to lose, so you pop your elbow off so you can get the restart.
Yeah.
Like that's it's pretty cheap.
That's again gray area. Some people might find it cheap. Some people might not.
Right.
If you're playing within the game, you're playing the game. Like you got to play to win. And
the thing is, yeah, both opponents had an opportunity
to do that exactly
within both of their abilities.
And there's referees who are there to enforce the rules and sort of watch or, you know, observe whether or not you are trying to break the rules, right?
Yeah.
So what is cheating? Cheating would be like putting weights in your gloves in a boxing match so that you can crush the guy's skull harder.
Yeah.
Or
deflating the football.
So that you can throw it in the cold better.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a great example. Or the squat briefs.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, the powerlifting meet.
A lot of guys. I mean, not a lot of guys, but it is something that happens.
It's happened, yeah.
Yeah, where people will put on a squat brief underneath their singlet, and then they get an extra 30, 40 pounds on their squat. And if they're not setting a world record, then they don't get checked. Like nobody checks to see if they're wearing a brief.
No.
Right. So I mean, that's a perfect example. If they want, they could win the meet, not set a record, and they won't get checked. And they might, and if they get tested for steroids, they might test like clean and everything because the only advantage they were looking for were the squat briefs.
Yeah.
That's cheating.
That's cheating.
Right. As far as PEDs are concerned, when do they become cheating?
So PEDs only become cheating if the federation that you're competing in doesn't allow PEDs.
Exactly.
If your federation is untested, then it's fair game.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, in the arm wrestling world, there really aren't any federations that are testing.
No, the only federation that tests is WAF, and they only test in competition. So it's impossible to tell if the athletes in WAF are taking steroids out of competition, and it's so easy to be clean on any specific day that you want.
Yeah, if you know the day that you've got to piss clean, you can use pretty much like the rest of the year and figure out a way to piss clean for that test. So a competition setting where they test in competition only, it's better than a competition that doesn't test at all, but it is still no guarantee that the person you're going against is 100% natural. The only way for that is out of contest testing, which is what they do for like the Olympics, what they started doing for the UFC.
Yep.
It's USADA, right?
Yeah,
USADA testing. And what that means is they can come and they can test you at random at any point without your knowledge. And even if you just avoid the test for a certain period of time, like a half hour or something, they'll call you on a fail. That is like the most legitimate way for sure to tell that somebody is 100% natural. So for powerlifting, for Olympic lifting, for track and field, I think some sort of forms of bodybuilding might do it. Like there are sports where they go to that extent. Unfortunately, arm wrestling isn't that big. Nobody goes to that extent. So you have to accept the fact that PEDs are a part of arm wrestling.
Yeah.
Right?
And we all want to see the biggest freaks of the freak battle it out against each other.
Yeah, there's a reason that the biggest league is the WAL and the PAL. There's a reason that they don't test.
Yeah.
You know, is because they want the craziest performances possible, you know?
Yeah.
And again, so then it becomes a competitive advantage. So it's no different than an earned competitive advantage like a bone lock or like in powerlifting as an example, Eric Spoto, who in the arm wrestling world we're all starting to become familiar with, as a bench presser, he can't drop the bar below, like to his chest, if he has less than 300 pounds on the bar. He's just too tight and
too muscled out, and
too big and jacked up to actually touch his chest. Now, once the bar gets over 300, he can touch his chest, and that's part of what helps him bench 722 pounds for a world record.
Yeah, and then Ray Williams,
yeah,
IPF world record squat holder,
yeah,
can't hit depth with anything less than 405.
Yeah.
Like he starts with 405 because anything
less than that, it won't even push him down to the bottom of the squat.
That's not enough. Like,
because he's earned over years and years of squatting, he's developed the muscles and the tightness to have that kind of strength in that position.
And that's an earned competitive advantage.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That's not unfair. That's no different than Michael Todd or Bob Brown having an arm lock.
Yeah.
Right? That arm lock is from years and years and years of arm wrestling and damage done to their arms and perseverance and continuing to arm wrestle. And then they have now earned the fact that their arm won't open. Now, a lot of people don't want to earn that. A lot of people aren't interested in having an arm that only moves this far, you know?
But, and then there's genetic advantages as well, right?
Right, exactly.
So like in basketball, for example, being born 6'10".
And having a 40-inch vert
yeah.
is you know, Zion Williams, that's a huge genetic advantage. He's genetically predisposed to play basketball. He's obviously an athletic freak and can do a lot of different sports.
Yeah.
But as far as the sport goes, basketball is 100% his sport. His talents would be greatly wasted becoming a bicycle rider or a jockey on a horse. You know, and like another example would be Wilt Chamberlain, you know, probably the freakiest basketball player of all time. Like, what other sport was more... was he more perfect for than basketball? Yes, he could do a ton of other sports, and he was great at a lot of other sports too, but there's no other sport that was better for him than basketball. So was he a cheater at basketball because he was so genetically predisposed to play basketball? No.
Huh.
And would you have wanted to see him do something else? No, we wanted to see him play basketball. Like, did anybody like it when Michael Jordan went to play baseball? No, we wanted to see him play basketball because guess what? He's the best basketball player ever. He's genetically predisposed to jump over people and shoot like a fucking madman. So we want to see him play basketball.
Yeah, and right? Then there's genetic freaks in arm wrestling too.
Yeah.
You've got guys with stupid high insertions in their forearms like Oleg Zok.
Yeah.
And they just grow.
And a genetic mutation where his left arm actually grows twice as fast as his right.
Yeah.
You know? So is that a cheat? And we had one guy, we can put the comment up. One guy said that is a cheat. Well, unfortunately, we disagree with that.
So he shouldn't be allowed to arm wrestle.
He shouldn't be allowed to arm wrestle on his left arm, or he should have to arm... Like, what are they going to do? Weigh his arm and say, oh, you're in the 225 class now, or your arm is bigger, you're a super heavyweight now based on your arm size. Like, no. It goes by weight class. Yeah. It's just the way it is.
What makes arm wrestling so great is that we can find these freaks like Oleg who would have no place in any other sport, really.
Right.
But they found their sport in arm wrestling and they dominate it.
Yeah.
Why would you want to get rid of these guys from our sport?
And the point being, too, is that it doesn't make you the world champion. Look at someone like Khaled. Khaled has all the genetic predispositions to be the best arm wrestler on the planet, no questions. His hand, his bone structure, how strong he is already, if he really hasn't trained and all that, which I do believe. I believe he's new to it and he's just built his strength off working. There is so much potential there, but if he doesn't work his ass off to become world champion, he doesn't become world champion.
Just like Oleg, whose left arm was weaker than his right when he first started, and he didn't know.
He didn't even know about his genetic predisposition until
he started training.
Exactly.
And then he realized,
holy shit, this thing grows.
Now, and then he actually works hard.
Yeah.
He can actually become a world champion.
Exactly. Yeah. So these are all just different types of competitive advantages. And we don't think that competitive advantages are cheating.
Yeah.
If they're earned or if they're genetic, they're not cheating. Now, where the gray line comes is with whether they're chemically enhancements. And in that case, again, it's only if it's the federation telling you that you're not allowed to use it and you go in and use it, that's cheating 100%.
And slimy.
Yeah. And just don't do that. Yeah. If you're going to use, go and compete where everybody uses. There's lots of places where that's what happens, right? Lots of people agree, we use, let's just compete together. It's not fair to go play with the people that want to play naturally.
Yeah.
Okay? And if you want to play naturally and you really feel adamant about not going against somebody who does use,
then you got to find a federation that tests and does out of competition testing as well.
Exactly.
Because that's the only way to really
know. But
if you're going to compete in strength sports as a whole, you just have to expect that at the top of the food chain, everybody's using.
Exactly. Yeah. It's just part of the game.
Yeah.
You know?
Don't hate the game.
Yeah. Don't hate. Well, I think it's don't hate the player, hate the game.
Oh.
So that might not work in this situation. Well, no, that does work. Hate the game. If you hate the federations that let people compete without testing, hate on them and love the federations that do out of competition testing and USADA and really make sure that everybody goes 100% natural and push for an arm wrestling league where they do that. That would be the only way to make it happen, you know?
Yeah.
So again, we come from the fitness world. This stuff is a lot more talked about in the fitness world, but it's still taboo. One of the big things that they do there is they expose it and they talk about it so that people can't get away with being fake naturals.
Yeah.
And it also helps give everybody a more realistic idea of what's possible, both aesthetically and physically, like as far as performance goes.
So if there are any arm wrestlers out there that you guys want us to assess whether they're natural or not, hit us up in the comments. Let us know who we should do a natty or not on.
Yeah. Other than that, like the video, share the video, subscribe, comment.
All the things.
All the things.
Monkeys out.
Peace.